Hi and welcome to the SHTICK. This week we've got with us a special guest who's been on before about a very controversial subject, and I'm going to introduce you to Manny Wax. Hi Manny.
Hi Henry, thank you for having me again.
That's all right. Last time you were on for three segments, and it was a year ago.
Wow, time flies.
And a lot has happened in that year.
It has. A great deal has happened.
And we talked about a very controversial subject, which is child sex abuse. And you've been very much at the forefront of the whole controversy, particularly in the Jewish community. Tell us how the last year has gone.
Well, it's difficult to think about timelines exactly, but probably from my personal perspective and also from the Jewish community's perspective, the biggest probably development was in relation to David Tsipras, where he was the trial was completed and he was found guilty in relation to one case, and then in the other eight cases of abuse or eight victims, he pleaded guilty. So under a plea deal, he's currently sitting in jail. He was received an 8.5 year sentence, something like that in total. 5.5 years was non-parole period, so a minimum of 5.5 years he'll serve. So it's a great achievement in and of itself. It's not an easy process to go through as victims, and so many victims went through this process for their families as well. You've got to think about all of the bad experiences you did have as a child, even though in all but one of the cases, we didn't have to go through testifying again, even though we did in the committal hearing, which is a separate process in the lead up. But we still had to, or we were offered the opportunity to write victim impact statements, for example, as every victim has that opportunity. And it's not an easy thing to do, because you actually have to think back, reflect on how you were before the abuse, when the abuse itself happened, what happened afterwards, ways it has impacted your life. So it certainly is a very arduous process.
Mm. And also there was the Victorian Commission into the child sex abuse issue. You made a statement there, or you represented Tzedek.
Yes, well, actually, there was a Victorian Government inquiry, and that was, we provided a submission, a written submission, and then an oral submission. Mm. That was in the end of 2012, or about September, October 2012. And it was actually before, just prior to the establishment of Tzedek. It was probably one of the catalysts for establishing Tzedek, because until that time, it was really me alone on behalf of victims informally. Mm. So really what I felt was, it can't be just about me, it's not Manny Wax doing it. This is really a community issue, and therefore we need to set up the right infrastructure. And that's exactly what we've done. We've got a proper governance in place, a board of management, board of advisors. We've got many volunteers assisting us. So it's been significant progress from that perspective as well for the Jewish community. Now, you know, just over a year ago, we didn't have this, and now finally we do, and things have gone from strength to strength, thankfully.
Because it's all about action, isn't it, really? Because there was the whole controversy as well with the Yeshiva College, where you were a student, where you were abused.
Yes.
And you threatened to sue the Yeshiva College. Is that process going through at the moment?
Well, one of the things that I did say, once we finished the criminal trial, I did say that many other victims, myself included, are planning to take civil action against Yeshiva for those crimes. In at least some of the cases, it may
wasn't
have been...
Wasn't it about their inaction? Wasn't
that's exactly really, right.
That's what it was
so
all
the,
about.
So part of the allegations is that, for example, one of them is that they knew about allegations about Tsipras early on and they failed to act.
Yeah.
And therefore, I know in my personal case, being abused in 1989, after they were forewarned plenty of times about him, had they taken correct actions at the time, there's a good chance that he wouldn't have abused me. But, well, we should leave that for the courts when that will get there. Certainly from my perspective, I do intend to follow through with that, because the way Yeshiva has behaved subsequently, you know, over the past couple of years. And this is the Yeshiva leadership we're talking about, as opposed to just tarring everyone, the entire Yeshiva community.
No, because the buck stops with the head of the Yeshiva.
Yes, and the reality is, no one who was in a leadership position back then has been held to any account.
Mm.
Some of them are still in the same, perhaps even most of them, are in the same leadership position as they were back then. Many on today's board at Yeshiva were board members then, and the executive and different layers of leadership roles. And no one has been held to account. No one has taken responsibility. There was one sort of apology, which was full of problematics, let's just say. And from my perspective, I have not accepted their apology, pseudo-apology, I would call it. And pretty much all the victims I've spoken to, I can't think of anyone who says yes, that they've forgiven Yeshiva for the way they've behaved or anything like that.
Yeah, so. Because the Orthodox rabbis have a policy called Mesira.
We need to be careful, yes. Mesira. Mesira is a concept of informing about fellow Jews to the authorities. It stems from Eastern Europe during the anti-Semitism and the pogroms over the last few centuries, and where if a Jewish person would go to the police authorities and say, my neighbor here stole off me, well, just that in itself could create problems for the entire Jewish community.
Right.
So it was taught, the concept of Mesira, which was informing about a fellow Jew, came into being, into taking...
So it was all kept in-house.
That's exactly right. Ultimately, it was about dealing with things internally. And the problem is some within the rabbinate feel that this is an appropriate matter in which to invoke the concept of Mesira, child sexual abuse. We've got to deal with it internally. No one has argued the case that if someone is suspected of murder, that we don't go to the authorities. It's really only in this type of case that it's been invoked. So, and again, it's not all the rabbinate. There are many great rabbis in Australia from the Orthodox rabbinate. In fact, Rabbi Moshe Gutnik, who's the president of the Orthodox Rabbis of Australasia, I'm fortunate enough to call him a friend. We speak quite regularly. He's been on my radio program. I go to him for advice. So, and he comes to me for advice. It's great. I just wanted to emphasize, it is not everyone.
No.
But there is enough. There are enough such people, not just in Australia, in the global Jewish community, where leading Orthodox rabbis have an issue with Jews going to the police, to the law enforcement agencies, and sharing this type of information with them. And it's a problem.
There was a feature article about you and your father, particularly your father, Zephania, who was alienated from the yeshiva community as such. And what's the outcome of that?
Well, the outcome of that is probably that they're now both in Israel. My parents went a few weeks ago. And they will be back because my mother still has a shop in Turak. So she's...
Chaya's Wigs, by the way.
Chaya's Wigs, that's right. Yeah. Wax Wigs, it's called, actually. Wax Wigs on Malvern Road in Turak.
That's right.
So they've got a business, and also they haven't sold the house yet, so they've got things to come back to. But for all intents and purposes, they are out of their community. They've been excommunicated. If they will come and spend half a year here, something like that, they will purchase or rent an apartment closer to her shop. They won't go to the yeshiva shul for the synagogue. So ultimately, that is a poor reflection on our community more broadly, but specifically on the yeshiva community. Despite the fact that it's not everyone there, the reality is if enough people would have spoken out from that community about this, probably wouldn't have happened. But sadly, I understand why many of them are reluctant to speak out publicly about it, because I do know of certain circumstances where people do speak up, and it's not consistent with the mainstream Orthodox or ultra-Orthodox or yeshiva view, that it may cost them in whatever ways. So it's easy to rush to judgment, but I think we just need to be careful about that as well.
Yeah, well, it has really caused a rift. This whole issue has caused a rift, and particularly in your family.
Absolutely. Look, and it's not unique to Australia. It's an issue around the world. Anytime there are victims who stand up to say what's happened to them, victim advocates in particular, when they take a strong position, they start organisations, it is a particularly challenging area. And that's probably one of the reasons why so many are reluctant to come forward, because there's no one else besides myself from the Australian Jewish community who's come forward about being a victim, even though I'm in contact with many, many victims.
Yeah.
There's one other, Yaakov Wolf, who did say that he was a victim in an article in the Forward magazine in the US, Rabbi Lebel Wolf's son, and he was someone who's courageous enough to say that he was a victim as well. But why are there no other victims coming forward?
That's an interesting question.
Probably because they feel a little bit unsafe about it. It's not only because of fear of intimidation. It could be because people are, it's an embarrassing thing to say that someone violated me as a child.
No one wants to talk about it.
You know, I'm not proud of that, but it's just, now it's become a bit of a mission. I've put myself out there. I represent those who are voiceless, and I hopefully provide them some sort of support and encouragement and empowerment.
Through Tzedek.
That's right.
And we're having you back in the next segment, Manny. We have to go out now. We'll be back after a break with some more of Manny Wax and his radio show, which is on J-Air, which is the Jewish Australian internet radio online, and also some of the issues and topics surrounding the Jewish community.
Looking forward to it, Henry.
Thank you. We'll be back after the break.